It says Gwen Sargent enjoys researching Appleton history. Well, that and millions of other things. I'm convinced, her husband's here, so he can probably attest to this. I'm convinced she gets no sleep. All the things that she's involved with, all the things that she does, it's unbelievable. Gwen, of course, is the chief operating officer of the Appleton Bicycle Shop. She's been working in the family bicycle business for 25 years. She started when she was 5. Her grandpa started the Appleton Bicycle Shop in 1939. Gwen and her husband Joe have 3 children, Joey, a freshman at West High School, Helen in 8th grade, and Augie in 6th grade, and both Helen and Augie attend the Kaleidoscope Academy at the Roosevelt campus. Gwen is in charge of our cemetery walks and has done a phenomenal job with that, the newsletter, and everything else she does for this great organization. So without further ado, please, a warm welcome for Gwen Sargent.
Tonight I will be presenting the history of Appleton Pioneer Cemetery and Riverside Cemetery, Appleton. Both cemeteries are tied to Appleton's rich history. Pioneer Cemetery, a ghost of the past, and Riverside Cemetery, a historical gem still existing today. This is by no means an exhaustive history. I could spend many, many more hours researching the depths of the minutes of the association to create an even more extensive history. The cemetery history will likely be an evolving history as more comes to light and more pictures come from people's private collections. If you have pictures, please bring them to that November picture show. That's my plug for bringing your pictures. The first recorded funeral in Appleton took place on October 15, 1849. The child of H.N. Day passed away. A.B. Randall preached and then assisted in burying the dead. It is unknown where that first burial took place. I imagine in that moment they had to consider how and where they would bury the dead in the future. The first cemetery was a community endeavor. It was laid out on 2 acres donated by Mr. Amos Lawrence on the western part of the Appleton Platt in the early 1850s. It was a section of land northwest of the intersection of North Brown Street, Superior, and West Edward Street, Washington. This slide shows the inset of that 1853 map. This map was given to the Appleton Public Library by Mrs. Greenough. The photograph is an 1867 picture. You can see the Hercules School, which is also on the map. You can also see the church on the left, the Episcopal, and the church on the right across from the school is First Baptist. Behind the churches by a city block is what was then the Pioneer Cemetery. So, school, church, and then way in the background there.
Stand near the mic, please.
And then way in the background there, we have, so this is the school, across is the church, and then the other church, and way in the background here is where you would have the cemetery. If you look here, this is the school, so the church was here and here. And then this is the cemetery in the background. Let me tell you which churches they are again. So the church on the left is the Episcopal, and the church on the right is the First Baptist. So you've got the Episcopal and the First Baptist.
When does that First Baptist associate?
Not as that First Baptist first stood. I believe that one actually burned. So that's a wooden church, and I don't think there is a wooden one there. The cemetery extended west nearly to the Mill Creek Ravine. It was bordered on the north side by the Chicago and Northwestern Railroad tracks and Fisk Street, Franklin, as we know it today. Mr. James Blood owned a small piece of land between the cemetery plat and the ravine. A number of people buried their friends there, supposing it would be donated, since it was perfectly wild and separated by the ravine from his other land. However, the price for the land was so exorbitant that they were obliged to give up the idea of getting the land. The first burial in the Pioneer Cemetery in 1850 was Erasmus Beach, and the second Amelia Bateman, a student who died of typhoid fever. Over 700 people were buried in the Pioneer Cemetery altogether between 1850 and 1872. This slide, an inset of a hand-drawn bird's-eye map of 1874, shows the tiniest of headstones below the trees. So you can kind of see that patch of trees. When you get up close to the microphone, there are tiny little headstones actually hand-drawn in there, and then your ravine here, Superior, so, Edwards. So, a lot of people have this map. I don't know if you've ever noticed that in there. An editorial appeared in 1853 in the Crescent by Sam Ryan Jr., "Our Village Cemetery. It seems that the place of burial for the dead of Appleton is owned by a cemetery association. We paid a visit to the spot a few evenings since, and we were pleased to find it occupying such a beautiful location. We now suggest to the directors or trustees that the ground should be laid out into lots, with suitable walks and alleys, and the brush cleared off, leaving a sufficient quantity of trees for ornament and shade, and the whole enclosed by a neat and substantial fence." The Appleton Cemetery Association met on January 2, 1854, and responded to the editorial. "Mr. Editor, the Appleton Cemetery Association is in existence." The trustees in 1854 included Jackson Tibbetts, P.H. Smith, R.A. Law, A.B. Bowen, Robert Bateman, A.C. Darling, George Lampier, Frederick Packard, and James Gilmore. A few photos of some of them that we could find. Late in 1854, the cemetery was greatly beautified, according to Ryan's History of Outagamie County. Appleton became a city in May of 1857, and the cemetery was a political topic of the day in Amos Story's campaign. Discussions were already underway about the current location of the cemetery, its size, and its place in the community. Amos Story passed away in 1862 and was buried in the Pioneer Cemetery. Mayor Gilmore, a cemetery trustee, carried the same interest in having a sufficient place for the dead to rest. In 1862, Mayor Johnson gave a speech. Johnson talked about the cemetery being a liability. It would soon be outgrown, and economically, it was in the interest of the Cemetery Association to buy a new site. July 23, 1870, an article appeared in the Crescent entitled, "A City Without a Cemetery." "Such a city is Appleton, almost." The Crescent goes on to describe the Pioneer Cemetery. "Take away some 2 acres of clay ground near the depot, surrounded by a coarse board fence without walk or adornment, either natural or artificial, and Appleton is literally a city without a cemetery. The need of a new cemetery for the city is not a new discovery. It has long been confused. The present cemetery is of insufficient size. There are now but few vacant lots, and none except in the ravine, which can only be used at a great cost. Exigencies of our present population will soon require ampler space. There is no opportunity of enlargement by addition. But even were the present cemetery large enough, or could it be made so, its location is against it. Within 3 blocks of the heart of the city, it lacks the retirement fitting to such a place. And further, it is seldom that a place of burial so near a business is long left invalid. A man who is sensitive about having his tombstone used as a hitching post of a beer saloon, or about having his bones dug up to make room for the engine houses, would wish to be laid in a place somewhat less exposed to the encroachments of business. Men do not like gravestones opposite front doors. Neither do they like them in wood piles of some adjacent backyard. August 1870, the Cemetery Association was investigated and the books reviewed. James Gilmore was the treasurer and secretary at the time. According to the statute, a meeting of the stockholders couldn't be held until the first Monday in January, at which time a new board would be chosen. At this time, the cemetery has less than 150 on hand and over 400 due from purchasers of lots. The association needed to remove a large portion of the forested trees in the spring, maintain the walkways, and put in a good fence. Everyone who has purchased a lot can vote to see that there is a desirable result. Leading up to the Cemetery Association annual meeting in 1870, the Cemetery Association asked that lot owners paid special attention to the election for the Board of Trustees. All who paid for lots should come prepared to vote. After the new board is organized, undoubtedly, all will be served with notice to pay for their lots or remove their debt. In 1871, the Appleton Cemetery Association was reorganized by an act of the Wisconsin Legislature. Jackson Tibbett, Samuel Ryan, N.M. Edwards, James T. Reeve, Joseph Harriman, James Hutchison, William Brighton, William G. Horton, and Cosby Ketchum were elected as trustees at the meeting February 20, 1871, and the association was legalized. March 14, 1871, an act of the legislature made it official. In the spring of 1872, the city set apart 20 acres for the purpose of a cemetery. It was resolved that if the Cemetery Association would plat, map, and stake this tract of city, the city would deed it 15 of those acres set apart. The city retained 5 acres for a potter's field. The main entrance would come from Second Avenue. We know Second Avenue as Wisconsin Avenue. The road coming into the cemetery was known as Cemetery Road. At this point, Brook Street, what we know as Pacific Street and the Pacific Street Bridge, didn't exist. And the river route was often washed out. So up on top here, this is Second Avenue coming across. This is what we know as Peabody Park coming up in here. So there was Old Green Bay Road that ran along the edge like this going up to Green Bay. But it was often, those sections were washed out. And so Cemetery Street, I guess, came in from this side into the cemetery. Captain N.M. Edwards set about platting the initial 15 acres for sale. The lots were in 12 grave sections. The lots sold for $10 without perpetual care. I imagine that's not probably how what they are anymore, Judy, are they? The initial lot sales took place in the fall of 1872. J.E. Harriman, Secretary and Treasurer, noted in the Appleton Crescent that the sale of those lots secured the inauguration of improvements to the grounds on a grand and beautiful scale, so tastefully and elegantly represented on the plat. The Crescent went on, "Reader, it is in your interest and to the interest of your friends that you select and secure a lot now, while the prices are low and desirable and locations are available. The Secretary of the Association will be present at the cemetery from 2 to 4 each afternoon until July 1st. He will have the chart and will give out all the information desired." So up here, this is Harriman, and this is Edwards. So Edwards did the platting, and Harriman was kind of the driving force behind it, both as mayor and as a attorney and private citizen and member of the association. This is Herman Erb, and Herman will come on the scene later. The first burial at Riverside Cemetery was that of the Reverend Thomas W. Orbison on November 10, 1872. At the time of his burial, his wife was distraught over the thought of him being buried in a lonely place. In 1872, 3 more persons joined Reverend Orbison. It wouldn't be long, though, before many more would join his company along the Fox River. J.E. Harriman hired the first superintendent of Riverside Cemetery, Dennis Mitem. The designs of Captain Edwards were carried out by Professor Yoakum. The lots, avenues, drives, and paths were laid out with necessary improvements by Dennis Mitem under the direction of J.E. Harriman. The Appleton Crescent noted that Riverside will be by far the most attractive cemetery in the valley of the Fox River. I think it still is. In the fall of 1873, 20 to 30 persons were removed from the old Pioneer Cemetery to Riverside. Among them were Anson Ballard and children, Reverend Dickinson, Mr. Jerry Grand, Mrs. Sam Ryan, Mrs. Robertson, and more. Next season, more will be removed. It appears often in the papers, the request for families to arrange to move their dead loved ones to the new cemetery. The new cemetery association begins plans for adding additional acreage and beautification. The Crescent delights in saying Appleton likes to be ahead in everything. Let us therefore hope that her citizens will not be negligent in expenditures for beautifying the last resting place of their loved ones. In 1874, they commenced improving the street on the river route to the cemetery. This street is called Green Bay Road. Green Bay Road was called such because it led all the way up to Green Bay. It was an old Native American and French Creole route along the river. Today, a road, well, more of a trail, exists coming up from the cemetery and along the river on the cemetery's property. The photo on the left is the bottom, and the photo on the right was taken about halfway up. The cemetery stone in the distance that you can see is the Conkey Family Monument on Black Sea. So this is the Conkey Monument on Black Sea. This is the roadway up, and this is towards the bottom, heading up the roadway. It is made of, still made of these stones and limestone, and then there's actually some, these edges right here are actually marble. Quite fancy. At the annual meeting of 1875, trustees were elected and they included N.M. Edwards, Sam Ryan, Jackson Tibbetts, Captain Spaulding, W.G. Horton, J.E. Harriman, J.T. Reeve, E.C. Goff, and Herman Erb. By October 1875, 145 burials had taken place at the new Riverside Cemetery, with 32 of them being reinterments removed from the old cemetery. At this time, there were a large number of beautiful monuments along them. Mr. Mudridge, Ms. Fenning, L.N. Benoit, J.S. Buck, Mrs. H.F. Patton, J.H. Carver, H.S. Babcock, Mrs. Orbison, Sam Ryan Jr., W.I. Butler, Hutchinson's, D.W. Briggs, Mrs. Hobart, J.A. Ryan, and W. Robertson, and M.H. Lyon. Powers and Hume, the proprietors of the Appleton Marble Works, furnished many of the elegant and beautiful designs. The Appleton Post said the quality of their work is unsurpassed. The appearance of Riverside Cemetery furnishes ample evidence of their taste and skill. So the ones you see up here, this is Benoit. This one is Patton. This is J.S. Buck. This one is Briggs. And this is a lot marker. A lot of the lots from that era have lot markers. What are left of them? Some have sunk, some are there, some are numbers, some are names. At one point though, in a new set of rules comes out, and then there you're not allowed to use corner markers like that anymore. So we see them in different spots. The Crescent, October 21st, had this to report. We allude to the subject so frequently that some may think us persistent in constantly keeping it before our readers. It has become an established saying that all people's tastes, culture, and refinement may be easily ascertained by visiting their cemeteries. Just in proportion as these resting places of the dead are reared for and beautified, may the citizens of the town be credited with the refinement that education, association, and culture brings. Appleton, thanks to the untiring, persistent energy of some of its citizens, succeeded a few years ago in securing the present beautiful site of Riverside Cemetery, which a more appropriately beautiful name could not be given to. And in spite of opposition, discouragements, and perplexities innumerable, its management has pursued a steadfast advance in fitting up and beautifying the grounds. Until now, it is already one of the most naturally attractive spots near our city, just removed from the bustle of business, beneath the wooded bluff of which rolls the quiet river, murmuring its daily requiem over the loved ones resting so quietly underneath those grassy mounds. When the spot was first selected, many ominously shook their heads over the location, having no faith in the ability of its managers to succeed in the undertaking that looked so vast in proportion to the financial demands that must be made to ensure success. but Judge Harriman, whose faith and efforts have never flagged in this grandest of monuments that he will leave for those in after years to enjoy, determined that this cemetery should be unsurpassed in natural and aided beauty by any other in northeastern Wisconsin, and he has succeeded most admirably. The plan of the grounds was made by Captain N.M. Edwards, which included a circular or semicircular form, with main avenues and serpentine gravel driveways giving a variety of form to the lots, square, octagon, circular, and avoiding any tendency to monotony. I've always wondered why they were so beautifully designed, so we're avoiding monotony. Another excellent improvement is now in progress and nearly completed. We refer to the ravine that enters on the eastern side of the cemetery. It naturally extended but a short distance. Now Mr. Harriman has a force of men work carrying out this ravine to the main avenue, which will be sodded and made to look as natural as possible. This will serve two purposes, relieving the monotony of the grounds and at the same time thoroughly draining all that part of the cemetery. At the avenue terminus, it will be nearly 6 feet deep. North of this, another ravine puts in, which in time will be carried entirely across the cemetery, connecting with a deep ravine on the western side over which bridges will be thrown on the avenues. To do all this requires money, and the funds can only come through the sale of lots. Now, when Mr. Harriman calls our citizens to sell lots, let him be met in a heartily cooperative spirit, remembering that he is engaged in a labor of love, giving him his time and best energies to this great work, without other of hope of reward than just pride in his home and surroundings. So I was fascinated by the idea that those ravines that were running through the cemetery were hand dug. I knew Appleton had a lot of ravines, and I guess I thought they were part of the natural landscape. So I kind of had a little heart attack a few years ago when they filled them in, thinking, oh, they're filling in that natural landscape. It turns out that's exactly what it looked like back in 1872. Messrs. Berg and Arndt were contracted to complete the grading on a new northern route to the cemetery. A new, easier grade was made from North Street to Green Bay Street with a new culvert put at the ravine crossing. Now there is no danger of being washed out. The drive is now open to the public and is one of the most beautiful in the city. It lessens the distance to the cemetery by over one half. Judge Harriman is tireless in his efforts to make the cemetery attractive and approaches pleasant. In 1875, word comes that the cattle are constantly breaking into the old cemetery. The fences are dilapidated, and there is not a fund from which to pay for the needed repairs unless the Common Council should decide to make an appropriation from the General City Fund. Another push is made for persons to move their relatives from the old cemetery to the new. In 1876, Mayor Harriman adds 12 acres to the Riverside Cemetery plat. Dennis Mitem, superintendent, clears out underbrush and helps to create additional avenues and ravines throughout. The ravines add immense beauty to the grounds. In 1877, the Crescent noticed the additional work laid out by Judge Harriman. The cemetery saw many improvements, including the monument erected by O.W. Clark. The first greenhouses were built south of Block M, and Dennis Mitem in charge. Throughout the years of the cemetery, the greenhouse brought in more funding than the lot sales in those years. So the greenhouses, the original greenhouses, this map is actually after what I'm talking about, so I'm going to show you. The original greenhouses were located more in this location. They say south of Block M, so this would be roughly where Block M is, kind of like that. So the greenhouses were actually located in here early on, and they weren't moved up to this location until 1889, I believe. So more will come on that later. In 1878, David Smith's monument has arrived. This was reported in all the papers and was big news of the day. A sketch was shown in the newspaper. It was made in his native Scotland, and the material was the best Scotch granite. The Crescent said it will serve to greatly beautify Riverside Cemetery. And those, the other color pictures are today, obviously. I just took those last week. Large monument. The decision was made in 1879 that trustees of Riverside Cemetery would remove the remains of the soldiers from the old cemetery to the new. The decision was announced at a common council meeting to make preparations to commemorate Decoration Day. The announcement was made by O.W. Clark Mayor, P.J. Circle, City Clerk, and E.C. Goff, President of Riverside Cemetery Association. In 1880, we caught up with our first vandals listed in the paper. Two women were prosecuted for willfully and wantonly mutilating choice shrubbery in Riverside Cemetery. You cannot pick flowers in the sacred ground. It's against the law established, and that law established that punishment for such things would be imprisonment for no more than 3 months. Or a fine of $100. Can you imagine in that day? Don't pick the flowers. These pictures are recent, obviously. The Alexander and Alice Reed monuments. And then flowers out front. The flowers are absolutely gorgeous at the cemetery. In 1888, the greenhouses were removed to a more accessible location and convenient place at the end of the streetcar line. The Cemetery Association erected a new Riverside greenhouse. Dennis Mitem was in charge, and all those profits supported the beautification and support of the cemetery. The streetcar began operations in 1886 from Appleton Junction to Riverside Cemetery. So at this point, Brook Street has become Pacific Street with the bridge, the new Pacific Street Bridge. The greenhouses were eventually sold in 1908. So they were relocated here. If you look on the back table, Tom has brought an amazing photo that is looking from Brook Street down into the cemetery, and you can see the greenhouses. It's a wonderful photo. If you get a chance, take a peek at that on your way out today. After many years and many requests made by the Cemetery Association, in March of 1889, the state legislature required the city of Appleton to pay to move the last bodies from the old cemetery. The city agreed to pay $8 per removal and interment. No remains shall be left undiscovered. They estimated that there were between 200 to 300 bodies left to be moved. The process of moving began in 1889 and continued. In November of 1891, Dennis Mitem and a force of four men were engaged to move the bodies of an additional 6 to 8 people to Riverside Cemetery. The old burials were near the Northwestern Depot. One of the graves opens dated back to 1850 and was one of the oldest in the city. The persons were reinterred in the city's Potter's Field until part of it was washed away by the river. At that point, Dennis Mitem suggested that he be allowed to bury the poor throughout the cemetery, a more discreet method. In 1892, an additional 3 blocks of new lots were added to the northwest portion of the cemetery. The addition added 200 more lots to the plat. A 20-foot avenue encircles the blocks in widening curves with 8-foot walk on each side. The lots on the avenue were 16 by 20 and would sell for $50. The back lots for $40. Smaller ones were available for $35 and $30. The greenhouse at this point yielded an excellent income to help support the cemetery. March of 1894, it was declared that all the bodies had been removed, the last work being done on March 31st, 1894. 366 removals were done, and with only about 30 of those bodies being claimed, the rest buried in the city lot at Riverside Cemetery, and then throughout the cemetery when Mitem got the chance to move them. There were many ideas of what should become of the old cemetery, including suggestions that the ravine from Pearl Street all the way to the cemetery should be turned into a park. The trustees were given authorization to sell the old cemetery grounds in 1889. The Cemetery Association paid taxes on the Pioneer Cemetery property until its sale in 1900 to Hettinger Lumber. John Hettinger, president, and Edward C. Schmidt, vice president, purchased the property for $500. In 1905, workers building a house at the west end of Edward Street, we know it as Washington, discovered a pine box with a child in it. They found an additional child's skull with more excavation on the site. This was the first discovery, despite the additional houses and lumberyards built. Throughout the years, additional bodies were unearthed all the way through the 1930s. And based on my math, there's probably some bodies left over there, so. So this parking lot area in Hirsch is really the main section of the cemetery. At the time, this would have been a ravine that was probably 50 to 60 feet deeper than that location is today. Because this whole section was a large ravine running through here. So you can kind of see the ravine running underneath here in the Hettinger lumber picture. Year after year, it just kept getting filled in and filled in and filled in, so it's pretty deep in there. But this picture of Hettinger lumber is essentially this parking lot. And then the Post Crescent building is where these buildings were located, so.
The post office is on a city dump, and that was where it'd be near cool.
Yeah, the post office here, further up was the pointer here, was also part of the ravine. So that ravine actually stretched from there down Division Street, clear through to what we know as Jones Park today. So at the time, that was Pearl Street. Yeah, and from here, you're correct, it did. It ran all the way out to Richmond Street and then all the way to, down to the river. There were 22 ravines, and they were quite deep and quite lengthy, and so Appleton actually filled a lot of those ravines throughout the years, so. In 1903, the cemetery trustees traded Block M in the new additions for Block K, which was currently occupied by the old soldiers and location of the Decoration Day celebrations each year. The lots in K had become completely full. The new location on M would give the veterans more room for a monument and additional grave space. The 25 veterans buried on K were removed to Block M. Appleton began celebrating Decoration Day in 1866 at the Pioneer Cemetery in honor of the Civil War veterans. Appleton continues today celebrating Decoration Day, now known as Memorial Day, with a parade and ceremony on Block M at the GAR Monument. The Grand Army of the Republic unveiled at the 1925 Decoration Day services its new granite square monument. The monument cost $2,000. So this is K. So there's a section in K that was traded, and then the bodies were moved, and now they are spaced out around the GAR monument with additional spaces. It gave them a lot more space to bury additional veterans. In 1906, the cemetery officers began planning for a chapel. A committee was put in charge of the arrangements. The committee included John McNaughton, George Miller, and Humphrey Pierce. The trustees approved of those designs in March of 1910. The much-needed chapel and vault construction began. It was decided that the chapel would be erected near the main entrance to the cemetery where the old greenhouses had been located. 1908, roughly, they removed the greenhouses and pushed them across where you would, the street there. So that allowed them to be able to actually erect the chapel in that location. The much-needed chapel and vault construction began. The vault would hold 40 bodies, and the chapel would seat 104 people. So this is the vault over here. That's just the top cement section. There's basically four different sections to the vault of cement, and then you could push the coffin in there. That's the door to it. The chapel, inside the chapel, and then the pews. The pews inside the chapel they're gorgeous pews. The woodwork is gorgeous. So the vault is no longer used. Judy kindly let me in there the other day, though, to get that little snap for you. So I've always wondered what it looked like in there. Okay. Whoops. Back up. In August 1910, the pews for the chapel had arrived, and the finishing touches were being put on the interior woodwork for the chapel and the office. The limestone walls and green Spanish tiles added a touch to the building. The structure would soon be ready for use. W.W. Waterman was the architect for the structure, and it cost $11,000. In 1911, A.W. Priest gave the Cemetery Association $3,000 to construct a bridge over the new Riverside entrance to the cemetery. This was the second of his noble gifts. As a philanthropist, A.W. Priest also donated the Soldiers Square Monument. As a part of the gift of the bridge, A.W. Priest was able to choose the location for his mausoleum and move his family to that burial location. The bridge was removed in 1989 due to its deterioration. So if you look at the map, this is the location of the bridge. So today, if you came in the front gates of the cemetery and you went past the office, and you come along here, when you get right to here, this is just where they do a lot of work right here. But that is the location where the bridge used to come across. This is the priest mausoleum right here. And we did do, that was one of the cemetery walk people. The bridge had a large stone chiseled with A.W. Priest Memorial Bridge. That stone today sits behind Hearthstone, the home of A.W. Priest and his wife. Additional sections were added in 1903, 1905, 1910. This 1917 map is a culmination of those additions. Dennis Mitem retired as the superintendent of the cemetery after 51 years in 1924. I'll read from you just a few words about Mr. Mitem. Mitem remains an optimist after 51 years as head of Riverside Cemetery. There are golden jubilees and golden weddings, but none so unique as that of Dennis Mitem. His anniversary is spoken of as a golden wedding because he constantly speaks of his job as the one he was married to for more than 50 years. Mr. Mitem recently retired on pension from service as superintendent of Riverside Cemetery, in which capacity he was employed for 51 years, a record that probably is not equaled by another employee in Appleton. The little city of the dead over which he had charge for 51 years had grown to such an extent that its population numbered 6,674 on January 26th. Mr. Mitem dug graves during the first few years of his employment, but has had nothing to do with that work for the last 45 years. He has had supervision of the lot, sales of lots, and general upkeep of the cemetery. He is succeeded in work by his son, Stephen Mitem. Mr. Mitem explains whimsically how he was led into the cemetery work unaware. He was previously a railroad man and might, except for certain circumstances, still be identified with railroads. Yet one day in the spring of 1873, he accepted employment from J.E. Harriman, then secretary and treasurer of the Riverside Cemetery Association. He was engaged for 6 months at $2 a day. He was put to work at grading a road in the cemetery and laying out a few lots. But, said Mr. Mitem, I have nothing to do with the cemetery. I hired you for 6 months at whatever work I choose for you, was the laughing reply from Mr. Harriman. There was a merry glance in his eye as Mr. Mitem added, that's how I got married to this job. He described the surroundings as a howling wilderness at the time he started work on it, and that was the year after the Cemetery Association was organized. It was that to such a degree that the good residents of what was then Appleton declared it a shame to have a cemetery so far from the heart of the city. They called it a scheme to help out the liveryman, the narrator said. Today, the cemetery is almost surrounded by homes. And I think today we can say it's definitely surrounded by homes. Someday the cemetery will be as much in the city as was the original cemetery that was laid out on the site now occupied by Hettinger Lumber. The only graded road was once leading from 2nd Avenue to a north stone arch entrance. Mr. Mitem graded and graveled every other road in the cemetery. The Fox River has played many a freakish prank on the cemetery. It's robbed the plat of a little of its rightful property. No less than 30 yards of cemetery has been washed into the river, he maintains. An old tree which once stood on the bank went down the river many years ago. Gone is also part of the garden he used to keep near the river's edge. The character of Mr. Mitem's work might seem depressing, but it has left him still optimistic and of a jovial nature. He scoffs at the superstition about ghosts and assures that there is no such animal. In his 50 years of service, he saw but one ghost in the cemetery, and that was a stuffed one used by a practical joker to frighten a few timid passersby. Mr. Mitem is one of Outagamie's pioneers, his father having come to Appleton from Holland in 1853. He is also was a veteran of the Civil War. His son, Stephen Mitem, takes over for a few months, but is fired. That's all there was, fired. Many family burials took place over the years. These pictures include the burials of Joe and Carrie Steidel and Robert K. Kester, a baby. The Steidel plot is on Block M, and the picture's taken near Memorial Day. The platform for the ceremony is erected in the background of the picture in the upper left. So you can see back here, they've got the platform up and ready for the Decoration Day services, as well as there's some additional trees and a lot of different flowers for Decoration Day. And I love this one. I love this car in the background of that photo. Here's my car guy to tell me what that is. Earl Ballard and William Johnson are hired to be the caretakers of the cemetery. At this point, all of the graves are still dug by hand. Some new rules included that all the boxes must be made of concrete. There can no longer be the use of a pine box. The cemetery markers are limited to 20 inches in height, and the monument dealers must confer with Mr. Ballard before a new stone can be erected. Earl Ballard reported in February of 1929 that the cemetery vault was practically full. Under the current conditions, it takes a full day or more to dig the grave. This is the first year the vault has been so crowded, with over 50 bodies stored. In 1928, there were 207 bodies buried in total. I really like this photo with the photo of the founders in the background. And this is, I think, Abraham Lincoln. Is that who that is here? Yeah. Jesse Earl Ballard and his wife moved into the caretaker's house. They raised five daughters in this home. The back entrance to the home was the most used entrance, although the girls' dates often were the only ones using the front. Across from the house, there was a field where they played kick the can, croquet, and more. Jesse raised peonies, had a large vegetable garden with corn and tomatoes. It's a neat place to grow up, I was told. The photo on the left is 1936 in front of the garage shop area. The girls are left to right, and correct me if I got this wrong, guys. We have Arlene, LaVon, Nona, Jean, and Carol. Did I nail it? Okay. The girls are in the same order in the retake photo. The heights changed a little. I just love this picture. I had a chance to talk with LaVon, Nona, Jean, and Terry Mays, Arlene's son. We talked for a number of hours about the cemetery. Growing up, there was a neat experience. Many of the family members worked at the cemetery over the years, from the office to helping with Memorial Day preparations to digging graves. Their family cared for this amazing jewel of history. Now this one is Christmas inside the dining room, right? Yep, so that's in the dining room. And I just love these pictures of them, like everyday life out in front of this gorgeous cemetery. Memorial Day was a beautiful and reverent affair. Earl got up at 4 a.m. on that day to make sure every veteran's grave had a geranium plant and a flag. The gates would stay closed until the time of parade. When they entered, Earl would open the gates. Today, Nancy Peterson leads a group of volunteers to place flags on the more than 2,000 veterans' graves. Earl climbed to the top of the tower for these great shots. The photo on the left, looking west up Pacific Street, which was known as Brook Street, and the photo on the right, looking northwest from the tower. During Earl's tenure, this neat pamphlet on the cemetery was developed. The cemetery also added the gates and iron fencing. The gates to the cemetery were then and are now closed at dusk and opened at dawn. This pamphlet is really an amazing thing. Has a little tribute to Appleton's pioneers and some fantastic photos of the cemetery from that era and information about the community enterprise that is the Cemetery Association, as well as showing you how beautiful it is, lot owners, trends in burial at the time, and the special care of graves. So I'll show you all the pieces to it. At that time, Frank Harwood was the president, William Fannin, vice president, Joseph Coffin, the secretary treasurer, and Earl Ballard, the superintendent. There were additional trustees of Hagen, Vakes, Schmidt, Marston, Bradford, and Bolton. The entrance gained a water fountain and a pool at the base of the bell tower. The pool is currently filled with flowers each year. Jesse Earl Ballard retired in 1965 after 41 years of service to Riverside Cemetery. When Jesse Ballard retired, the following appeared in the Post Crescent October 31st, 1965, entitled "Never a Ghost," says a cemetery worker. Over 40 years in the cemetery and not one single ghost, alive or dead. That's the record claimed by longtime cemetery worker Earl Jesse Ballard, who at 72 will retire from his job as the manager of Riverside Cemetery. "There's nothing out here at night to be afraid of," Ballard remarked last week when asked to recall his experiences. "In fact, there's no safer place than a cemetery at night." Ballard admits he was somewhat apprehensive about taking the job as the assistant manager back in 1924 when the Cemetery Association hired him. "As a young fellow, I was reluctant to go with my parents to funerals. I was a little upset by dead people and didn't care to have too much to do with it," Ballard said. However, he said, several months of duty with the Allied forces in combat in France had acquainted him with the dead and dying, so he was willing to give a cemetery job a try at $75 a month. Although Ballard cannot recount any ghosts he has come across in the cemetery, there have been some strange goings on his side of the iron gates. "Once I heard snoring behind a dirt pile and it turned out to be a drunk. He was more frightened at the beginning, more frightened than I was, finding him there. Halloween's always a big time at the cemetery. Some human haunts would find pleasure in hanging steel grave markers in the cemetery during the long Halloween nights. Other times, he would find college students wandering the cemetery alone, looking for missing clues in the scavenger hunt. One student, a freshman, walked from tombstone to tombstone all night long before Ballard found him and helped him figure out the clues to the missing treasure. Twice, relatives have visited the graves of their loved ones and killed themselves on the spot. One young man, after visiting the cemetery, walked into the Fox River and drowned. Visiting a cemetery isn't as popular as it once was when Ballard started. We used to have people come every day and sit for hours near a grave. Some who were lonely used to talk to gravestones. Every grave in the sprawling 93-year-old cemetery is known to Ballard. He can, each Memorial Day, without checking the records out of most of the locations, find graves for inquiring visitors, and he's seldom wrong. Rudolph and Phyllis Splatecki were farmers from the Antigo area. Rudolph worked as the superintendent and Phyllis in the office. They were hired by the Cemetery Association in 1968. This is kind of a cool picture of the garage area that is now, this is actually offices now, and then this section is the boardroom. Terry, do you know what year that was, that the reconstruction? Yeah, I don't think that was 80s or 90s, so. Judy, do you know?
87.
80s? Thank you. All right. Rudy and Phyllis brought many different species of trees to the cemetery after the cemetery suffered greatly from Dutch elm disease. The cemetery originally had over 185 elms, and after Dutch elm disease, only 30 were left. Rudy could fix anything and build up whatever the cemetery needed to get the job done. Rudy built a tree watering device on wheels that his daughter Peggy took from tree to tree watering the new plantings. Rudy and Phyllis developed the tree walk that many students of Appleton schools can remember from the 80s and 90s. This is a sample of that tree walk. Does anybody remember it? I do. We collected leaves.
We collected
pine cones.
Pine cones? And made pine
cone wreaths out of them. Ah, collected pine cones and made pine cone wreaths out of them. A new house was also built during the Blatecki's time at the cemetery. Rudy was superintendent of the cemetery for 21 years. A few words from his eulogy. Rudy Blatecki was, among many things, a beautiful, simple person. He found joy in the greatest of God's first that most of us take for granted, the trees, the birds, the squirrels, the flowers. He was a connoisseur of nature. Rudy was much loved among his employees at the cemetery where he and Phyllis worked. He took time to care for his employees, to know their needs, and to offer the support they needed. And his unselfish way with them won him a highly respected place in their hearts. Since Rudy retired, many things have stayed the same and many have changed. Trees still come down and new trees are planted. New souls arrive for burial in a variety of ways. I just love this old photo. So there was a lot more research that could have been done and I could go on for a lot longer, but that is the end of part one, Riverside Cemetery. So, do you have any questions about Riverside Cemetery? This is the current map that they use to help point people in the directions they need to go. So often people come in and get information on their families and where they need to go. And I think it's really important to think about where your families are from. I'm interested in genealogy, so I'm always interested in what family members are at the cemetery and taking care of their spaces. Questions? The Ballard home that you saw in the presentation came down, and then that other house went up, that new house that you see there. Mm-hmm. Question? Part of St. Joe's, yep. Land speculation. There were trees, but not in the sense of like some of what it looks like today where it's really filled in. It's more of those photos you see of the Fox River Valley from the 1850s, 1860s. Typically there's a tree line, but it's not filled in like the buckthorn does today. So it looked a little bit different. The sections to the outside of it though, so this section here on the other side of Nawata Street. So at some point, in part two, I'll tell you about Nawata Street was vacated here by the city, so it was no longer a city street, and then they were closing the gates all the time here. This whole section was farm, though, from what I can gather. That was bought from George Scheffler and then one other name. So some sections of it were more of farm fields to start, but the part that was actually right along the river was really early, so it was really more about the people who owned it. So Harriman owned a big chunk of this section. When you look at those original maps, Anson Ballard owns part on this side and a part on that side. Frederick Packard owned a big piece of it. So a lot of those original names that we were talking about as trustees actually owned property surrounding it. Any other questions? So the other thing I'm going to just tell you, I don't know if I can whip back to it or not, but the chapel is actually going to be restored at the cemetery, which is really neat.
Yes.
So that's kind of an exciting thing, and it'll eventually be open for funerals and weddings. So that's something that's coming up. So there'll be a fundraising campaign kicking off too, to help with the chapel, which will be really exciting. So keep your eyes open for that. Yes. So the greenhouses, I think, just came down for extra space, so green space essentially, because they were actually in pretty bad condition, and so because they hadn't been operating out of that building for quite a while, so they were in pretty bad condition, and then that area came down. There's a section of parking, I think, if I understand correctly, and the rest of it for now will be green space. So
is that owned by the greenhouse?
That's by the Cemetery Association.
There's two newspaper articles on that back table that speak to that very question.
So there's a few people in the audience that I'd love to have stand up. So my Ballard girls, Terry Maves, Judy, these guys let me interview them and bug them and ask questions. And Judy let me bug her in the office. Stand up, guys. Yes, you too. Yeah. I really appreciate you guys letting me ask you questions and learn more, and I get the pictures from them as well.
Thank you for showing my playground.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. She said she wanted to thank me for showing the playground.
I know you didn't have a picture, but you might tell the story about Bing the dog.
Oh, yes. So there's a couple stories about different locations in the cemetery, and so I'll just hit a couple of them. I didn't add them in knowing it would be long, so I think I could do like a monuments presentation and just hit all monuments. But Bing is the dog in the cemetery. He's the only dog and animal in the cemetery. It's said, actually, Terry, I'm going to bug you to come up here and tell the story right so that it gets told right. Come on up.
it's in R, I believe, right?
Yeah.
He's in R.
Hang on, I'm going to give you the...
Just a little bit to the north, to the right of the R. Yeah, right in there. If you go through, you'll see a monument with a dog. And the story is that the dog went out and followed his master, who had died, and laid down in the grave and died. So he was buried there, and there's a lady, I'm not sure who it is. Do you know Judy?
She's deceased. Someone else is doing it.
Oh, there's a lady that comes out and puts a scarf around the dog and a ball in his paws. So if you go out there and look, you'll see that all the time. I actually, my brother and I actually worked out there. Earl was our grandpa, and so I actually buried three people out there. Judge Schmiege, if any of you remember Judge Schmiege, I'm sure there were a few people that would have loved to have thrown a few shovels of dirt and helped me bury him. So I personally did not know Judge Schmiege.
Thank you, Terry. Okay, are there any other questions? The last thing I need to just hit is the Cape Blood story. It's all a story. It's all a myth. None of it's true. We figure, I ask questions because I was like, is that a thing from the 60s and 70s? It's not. It appears the Cape Blood thing happened somewhere in the 80s, 90s is where that myth started. But and actually, she's not set apart. That's Section W, as you can see. So, and there's a couple other burials in Section W as well. And her daughter went on to create the cataloging system for libraries that they still use today. So, kind of an interesting story with her. Any other questions?
There's a stove out there too.
Yeah, the metal, like kind of a metal stove. I can't think what Reese, I think the name is on it. Is that right? There's a lot of really incredible monuments out there. So if you have the time, please go out and, you know, enjoy walking or biking, or if you mobility, you can drive in the cemetery. They've got nice blacktop roadways. You can get out there and see all of these incredible monuments, as well as the the history of the cemetery. So we really enjoy doing our cemetery walks out there. So thank you guys very much for letting us come out there to do them. So thank you.
Terrific, terrific.